all over the country, the race is on to bring in our food. It's harvest time!
Gathering in the bounty of the land is the most crucial event in the countryside calendar. And now, as this year's harvest reaches its climax, it's time to see exactly what's happening with all our crops. Seeds of life to sustain us, fresh vegetables pulled from the earth, fruit that's our sweet treat, all conjured up from Mother Nature.
We'll be discovering the remarkable craft and magic of farming and finding out just where our food comes from.
No matter how clever farming becomes, our crops are still at the mercy of the weather. Harvest 2012 was a disaster. After record summer rainfall, crops failed and prices spiralled.
Can 2013 put our farmers back on track to deliver the food we all rely on?
As the harvest comes in, we will reveal the results.
This time, we're getting a taste of British fruit.
We'll discover which of our sweet treats has had a vintage year.
Welcome to Harvest 2013.
We are in beautiful Herefordshire.
At the height of the cherry harvest.
I'm Gregg Wallace.
And I'm Philippa Forrester.
And as a greengrocer by trade, I'm here to find out how you get these fragile little fruits from the trees to the shops.
For me, it's all about the growing and the quality. I could never produce fruit like this at home, and definitely not on such a massive scale.
We've been tracking the progress of the cherry crop on this farm all year. Now we're here to bring you all the action from the harvest.
It is a delicate business. It requires high-speed precision picking and high-tech processing and packing.
Well, Gregg, you're going to have your work cut out for you today. You're joining the harvest team. 40,000 of these they pick per day. Are you up for that?
Don't you think I look fit and strong enough? Is that what it is?
No. I have my doubts.
Can I say, you watch. Actually, UK cherry growing is going through a bit of a renaissance at the moment. Over half the cherries we eat in this country are still imports, but British growers are definitely fighting back. And these guys, they're at the forefront of that revolution.
But we haven't just got our eyes on the cherries. We'll also be finding out how to grow super sweet strawberries and witnessing the sheer speed of the blackcurrant harvest.
Growing anything is always a gamble with the moods of Mother Nature. So food expert Stefan Gates gives us some of the scientific secrets of success.
2013 has been an extraordinary year for our fruit crops, starting with the long cold winter and then the very late spring.
We've been following the struggles of Herefordshire cherry farmer Andy Hunt. How has this year's unusual weather affected the harvest? We'll bring you the results from this farm and from all around the country. We'll discover who's won and who's lost in Harvest 2013.
And all we're missing now is the man himself, Farmer Andy. I know he's out there somewhere worrying about his cherries. Let's meet him.
Andy Hunt is a farmer with a singular talent for trees. He started out as a cereal farmer, then turned to vegetables. But 35 years ago, Andy found fruit. And now he's a pioneer for a new method of growing cherries. Whole orchards undercover.
The cherry tree requires a great deal of care and attention. We consider almost every tree as an individual. So we have 60,000 trees that we have to care for. I've always been keen on precision. In my own garden, I like straight lines. I'm even sat at the table rearranging my cutlery, which is all very sad, but that's me. And what I find about fruit farming is that you have to be very precise. We build tunnels, which are effectively buildings over your trees. So everything has to be planned, and that really suits my nature.
Andy lavishes months of meticulous love on his trees, but he can't gather in the crop alone. At harvest, he's joined by a team of 250 pickers and packers.
Although there's a real buzz on the farm, it can be quite stressful. You know, tempers can be a bit fraught. You know, we're all determined people here. Some people might even say obsessed about getting the fruit in. You know, it's very important to our futures at the end of the day. The whole business is about getting the cherries picked, packed, and sold.
Right, well, this is where it all started, is it?
It is. 20 years ago. This is the first cherries we ever planted on the farm.
So why cherries?
We knew that there was a market out there because virtually all the cherries that we eat in the UK are imported simply because of our weather, really. They're difficult to grow and nature tends to throw everything at the cherry.
Is it a particularly tricky one, the cherry, do you think?
Yes. It's been the most difficult challenge I think I've faced as a grower.
And presumably all that knowledge and all the rest of it still didn't save you last year. Was last year awful?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Last year we had incredibly low light levels. This had quite an effect on the taste of the cherry. And of course, cherries are all about taste. You know, this is why people buy them at the end of the day.
Do you know what I love about you, though? It's a complete love affair between you and the cherry, isn't it?
It is. It's become my passion, to be quite honest.
Elsewhere in the orchard, pickers are hard at work harvesting the cherries. This year, things are busier than ever. The unusual weather has brought mixed blessings for Andy. He's got a bumper crop of cherries, but they've ripened all at once. In a normal year, the British cherry season lasts 2 months. But this year, Andy's faced with the challenge of harvesting 40 million cherries in just 5 short weeks. The race is on. So what is it about the cherry that makes it so alluring? And why is it so difficult to grow?
Not so long ago, cherries were our favourite summer fruit. Their tantalisingly short harvest only added to their appeal. The Romans were the first to cultivate them in orchards across southern England. But growing cherries commercially is tough. To produce a good crop of fruit, the trees need a lot of looking after. Our traditional cherry orchards weren't fit for the supermarket age. The 60-foot trees were hazardous to pick, and exposed to the elements, there was always the risk a whole crop could be lost to birds or the weather. The cost and unpredictability of the home harvest sent supermarkets looking abroad. By 2000, only 1 in 10 of our British cherry farmers were still hanging on. Something had to change.
These trees have shrunk because they look nothing like those massive ones we've just seen on that piece of film. Why?
So we can pick them. It's a simple answer. The main reason we can achieve a small tree is by growing them on a rootstock. It's a dwarfing rootstock which controls the height of the tree.
You have got the root from one cherry tree and the rest from a different cherry tree.
Basically,
and you've stuck it together?
Yes, pretty much.
That is nuts.
Look, show him where it's done. You can see it down there.
This is what they call the union. Here's the rootstock, here's the tree.
And the bulbous bit in the middle is the join?
The bulbous bit in the middle is the join. It just sort of grows like that, and it grows on.
So the roots are governing how far the tree grows?
Absolutely.
That's fantastic.
But is it more productive, would you say?
Very much more productive.
Is it?
Because what you're doing now is producing a tree that's relatively small, hasn't got an enormous amount of wood or leaf, and it can put its effort into producing fruit. Everybody that grows trees for commercial harvest will grow them with this type of rootstock. It has revolutionised the UK cherry business.
In fact, these modern trees are 3 times more productive than the older ones. Before we find out what it takes to get the cherries off the trees, let's look back at what it took to get here. The story of our cherries actually starts way back in winter.
I enjoy this time of year. It's cold, crisp. You've got plenty of wildlife. The trees appear to be standing there idle, but actually within the tree there's a lot happening.
The January snow was great news for Andy, because each cherry tree needs a precise amount of chilling through the winter months to produce blossom in spring and then fruit in summer.
If it doesn't receive the right amount of chilling, it can affect the quality and the yield. And in extreme cases, it may not even fruit at all.
But it's not just cherries. All our fruit crops need those crucial chill hours during the winter months if they're going to produce fruit. So what's actually going on inside the plants? Stefan Gates reveals more about this mysterious phenomenon.
How do our fruit trees know when to start growing, when to flower, and when to drop their leaves? Well, it's all to do with the fact that plants really do feel the cold. When the trees lose their leaves in winter, they become dormant, and that's because they're genetically pre-programmed to shut down.
But what is it that causes the tree to wake up again? It's down to a mysterious process called vernalization. Take this apple tree.
It's only when the plant gets cold for a prolonged period of time that another set of genes is activated. And this begins the long process of preparing the plant for spring. It's a little bit like the plant's internal clock is being reactivated.
Prolonged low temperatures in winter trigger the release of a hormone called florigen. And it's this that kickstarts the plant into flowering and eventually to produce fruit.
To make an apple, the tree must endure around 700 hours of temperatures colder than 7 degrees. Without that, it simply won't flower as well when the weather warms up.
Andy's cherries need even more cold than apples, 1,200 hours to be precise. And this winter, they certainly got that. But the cold weather dragged on, and spring came really late. So Andy began to worry that he had another problem on his hands, that by summer, all his fruit would develop at the same time. And as if that wasn't enough, in July, along came the longest heat wave of this century. Those prolonged warm temperatures accelerated the ripening, and now all the cherries are pretty much ready at the same time. Will they be able to pick all the cherries while they're still perfectly ripe? Gregg's gone to meet the pickers that Andy's trusting with his precious crop.
Right, I've been told to come here. Bev, available between 12 and 2. I'm a bit early.
Bev Woodyat is in charge of the seasonal workforce at Lower Hope. She used to be a picker herself. Traditionally, all our fruit crops were harvested by local people. But like so many things in farming, times have changed, and now we employ thousands of foreign workers to do the job.
I greet the students, I do their inductions, make sure they got all the right paperwork, and I do their wages, and I look after the campsite. So I like their mum, but I don't cook and clean for them.
Why are they all Eastern European?
We do advertise for British people, but they don't seem to be really interested. We have had a couple, one lasted an hour, one lasted a day. It's hard work at the moment, it's a shame, but they just don't seem to want to do it.
On your office door, it says meeting by appointment only.
Yes.
Why is that?
Constant knock, knock, knock on the door. Things like, my light bulb's gone. What time is it going to stop raining?
At the height of harvest, Bev has 250 pickers, packers and pruners who all need housing in the farm's own campsite.
This is one of the caravans.
It's sizeable. How many people sleep in here?
This one's got six in. This is Evelina.
Evelina, sorry. Good to meet you. I just wanted to see how you all live and stuff.
Come in. Hello.
Hey! Great big television.
Yes.
Have you got satellite?
Yes, we have English satellite, Bulgarian TV. We can watch everything that we want.
Fantastic. This is quite cosy. I think I wouldn't mind a caravan.
No.
You wouldn't want to share a room with someone who's having nightmares, would you?
No.
Some of the workers stay here for up to 10 months of the year, so there's a strong sense of community around the campsite. They all cook together, they do their washing together. It's got a real holiday camp feel, except everyone's here for one main reason: to earn money. And they get paid by the weight of the cherries they pick.
Why do you publish everyone's earnings?
Well, they'd like to know every day how much they've earned.
This picker here,
yeah,
Matthews Kloos, is earning about £100 a day. In fact, there's four or five people there that are earning near on £100 a day.
Yes. If you're willing to work, you can earn good money.
What's the typical day of your cherry worker?
It could be 5 o'clock in the morning, it could be six, it just depends, and they normally work about 8 hours a day. Well, when they finish at night, it's one big mad dash to get in the showers. Usually it's not long before they're in bed, because obviously they've got to start and get up again 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, ready for the next day.
Much socialising here in the evening?
Yeah, they usually get together and have a drink. Mostly there's a birthday every day with this amount of people, if not two. And then we usually do barbecues for them.
Is there much interpicking romance? Or?
We've had marriages, we've had babies.
Really?
Yes.
That's fantastic.
It's 20 years since Bev was a picker herself. It's a lifestyle she grew up with.
How was it being a picker?
It's hard work, but it was fun. This is me.
No way.
Us kids used to sit and used to pick hops into an umbrella. It was when it was all done by hand.
Not a lot's changed, really, has it? Lots of people on the land then, all bringing in the harvest.
Yes.
But of course, there are plenty of other things that have changed.
Right now, everyone's racing to bring in this incredible crop. But we wouldn't have all these cherries without one thing: polytunnels. Polytunnels were introduced to British farming 20 years ago, and they've completely revolutionised our summer fruit industry by increasing the reliability of the harvest. Andy led the way in using them to cover whole cherry orchards. They allow him to control the growing environment to suit the precise needs of the trees. And the scale of his man-made cherry heaven is staggering. The tunnels go up in spring when Andy's team cover the whole orchard with a giant plastic roof. It's important the trees are protected from late frost. In summer, the polytunnels keep the ripe cherries safe from storms that would split them and devastate the harvest.
I have to say, I'll confess to you, I'm not a big fan of polytunnels, but it's lovely in here.
Oh, it's a lovely climate, isn't it? It's a beautiful climate. It allows us to amend nature, really.
Yeah.
We can make it warmer in the spring, but cooler in the summer.
How do you ventilate
them,
then?
Well, what we do, we use these poles.
Oh, this is not going to be press a button and the whole thing...
Not quite, I'm afraid.
How many miles?
We're not that high-tech. About 50 kilometres, which is also 30 miles of tunnels. So it's a lot of tunnels.
30 miles of tunnels.
Yeah.
So every time you decide, well, it's a bit hot today, so we'll give them extra ventilation, you've got to do 30 miles.
Yes.
Well, also, how much does that cost?
It costs us about £1,000
to
push all the tunnels up and to pull them down again.
Should we?
Yeah, well, I mean, let me show you how to work first. Basically, all you do...
30 miles, though. Tell you that.
No. we'll do this 30 yards.
Am I doing this with you, or
no,
you just showing
I'll show
me?
You.
Right.
You simply put the pole here, just on the bottom, and tuck it up underneath.
It's high-tech.
And push up.
But it works.
And that the rope's tighten and hold it. So if you'd like to try
That's
the next
it.
One... Yeah, what you do is come alongside the rope, just tuck it into here.
Honestly, seriously, by the time you've done this for 30 miles... It's midnight, isn't
it? Push it up. A little bit further, please.
Ooh. Quite particular.
That's,
is you, though, isn't it? You are so particular.
Very particular.
So
and
you
we simply go along, try the next one.
It's a good workout. So just like this. And in the winter, then, are they protecting them?
We actually take them off in the winter. If I can just show you what you've done wrong there, is you need to get the bottom underneath, then they won't slide down.
Right. Are you saying my work on the farm is sloppy?
Well, you'd need a bit of training.
And how much does this whole rig cost? You know, all your polytunnels and everything. How much is that in terms of investment?
We've spent about $2.25 million so far on building tunnels.
$2.25 million?
Yes, yes.
That's absolutely...
It's a massive investment.
It's a huge investment, isn't
absolutely.
It? But for you, it's the difference between growing cherries in the UK and
Well, without them, we wouldn't be growing cherries in the UK.
Yeah, and that's the same for lots of fruit as well, particularly one of our favourites, the strawberry, as Gregg has been finding out.
The biggest winner in the polytunnel revolution is the all-conquering strawberry. This sumptuously sweet berry has taken over from the cherry as our favourite summer fruit. It now dwarfs cherry sales by a massive 5-1 and makes up 80% of all the soft fruit we eat in Britain. The original wild strawberries still grow in our woods. They are delicately small and deliciously sweet, shade-loving berries. The larger modern strawberry was bred in France in the late 18th century and is much more of a sun worshipper. It's also a lot easier to grow than the needy cherry, which explains why the strawberry industry has doubled in the last 8 years. It seems there's no stopping this Goliath of the summer fruit world. Now there are strawberries being grown all over the UK, and not always in places that I'd expect. Here I am in Stonehaven, 500 miles north of London. And it's a beautiful little place. And when I think about food round here, I think about brilliant Scottish seafood, lobsters or herrings. Most certainly not strawberries. But look at these. Mmm. Oh, they are seriously good. And they come from just down the road here. I always think of strawberries basking in the sunny warmth of southern England. But in fact, the colder Scottish lowlands are surprisingly productive. Ross Mitchell grows over 200 acres of soft fruit on his Aberdeenshire farm. He believes there are some real advantages to growing this far north. But like Andy, he relies on polytunnels to keep out the worst of the Scottish weather. Inside, he's also adopting some really high-tech growing techniques that mean his strawberries lead a remarkably pampered lifestyle.
Not what I expected at all, mate.
Yep. So, Gregg, this is strawberry growing in the modern era. This is a hydroponic system that we're growing in, so there's no natural soil involved. We're taking in coir, which is coconut shells, ground-up coconut shells.
The plants sit in the coir, a very efficient growing medium that encourages better root growth and increased fruit production. And they receive their food through a network of pipes.
What exactly is going through these pipes? Water, I should imagine.
Water and all the nutrients that the plant needs. So they need nitrogen, calcium, potassium, phosphorus. So we're using computer models to measure the sunlight, the temperature, the humidity. And when that plant needs feed and water, it gets it.
Where would they have normally got those? From the soil?
From the soil, yep. And then in traditional methods, they would have got them through a granular fertiliser as well that could have been applied once or twice a year. But we're giving it fertiliser continually every time it gets water.
You're not actually giving the strawberry anything it wouldn't have had 50 years ago?
No. It's not getting anything. It's not a natural resource.
It's just getting it in a very different way?
Yep.
You've got it on a drip?
Yes. We're trying to take a lot of the variables out of it to grow a more consistent, even crop.
You definitely get more yield and better fruit from this system.
Yes, we do, yeah.
So how confident are you these are going to taste better than my Uncle Ted's ones in Kent?
Yeah, very confident. I think the proof of the pudding's in the eating, sir.
Oh, mate. That's a very good strawberry.
Seriously sweet, aren't they?
Maybe a little bit too much potassium in that one.
Is that right?
Maybe. The nitrogen balance is absolutely right.
It's all very futuristic, but things weren't always that way. Ross is part of a long tradition of soft fruit production on the east coast of Scotland. Since the 1890s, thousands of acres of land has been dedicated to growing soft fruit, much of which was sent under steam to London markets. The growing was tough without polytunnels, but farmers were making the most of one of Scotland's natural advantages. Daylight. And lots of it. In midsummer, this area gets well over an hour more daylight than Kent, which has a huge effect on the short life of the strawberry.
Ross, yeah. That's great. I mean, I'm taking it, they are the different stage of development of a strawberry.
Yeah, so we have a school lesson here. So we start off with an open flower, which then needs to be pollinated. So the centre of the flower then develops to become the strawberry. And you can see the different growth stages here. So between here and here, probably takes about 4 weeks. And then here and here takes about 2 weeks. Now this is the crucial stage where all the sweetness, all the flavour is put into the strawberry. So this is the very point where Scotland climate makes a difference to the fruit flavour.
The extra daylight hours means Ross's strawberries have longer to build up sugars. And because it's generally cooler up here, they ripen more slowly, giving even more time for the strawberries to develop their deliciously sweet flavour.
Hey, those berries were absolutely delicious, but these are as equally as delicious. And these are all Andy's cherries. And what I wanted to show you is, even though we think cherries are all the same, look at all of the different varieties.
Yeah, you can clearly see when they're put together, they are all very different, aren't they?
And this one here that I actually is my favourite looking one, this is actually called a sweetheart.
Is it? Ah, that's...
Isn't that lovely?
Yeah, that does look very cherry-ish, doesn't it? They're all different colours. Do they taste differently, then?
Well, they are. You grow your own. You like a good bit of grub. You taste. All right, taste the sweetheart ones. Taste another one.
This one?
See, okay, yeah, I can guarantee you they'll be different. See, these sweethearts, I think, almost taste like a glass of red wine.
They are very sweet.
This one is sweet, maybe a little bit deeper. Try one of these. These having these stones in it, OK, have caused a bit of a problem in recent years. I'm really pleased to hear that cherry sales are on the increase. Because of those stones, because they're difficult to eat, people have been neglecting them. We've all been getting a little bit lazy.
If I leave a bowl of cherries out on the table, they're gone in half an hour.
I don't think you agree with me that they taste like wine, do you, those sweethearts?
No, I don't really.
No? That's because you drink rubbish wine, obviously. What do they taste like to you?
It probably is, actually.
What do they taste like?
Well, they just taste sweet.
That, I think, tastes more like a blackcurrant.
I'm getting that, and they're also with the colour as well.
And this is the sweetest of all. Pick the last one up for me there. Mm. Okay. All I wanted to do, you like that?
That's much sweeter. Which one's that one?
Yeah, I don't know what that one's called.
That's.
But it's much, much sweeter than the others. And that was the point I was trying to make, all right? They are all very different.
And that's less sweet, isn't it?
That's the least sweet of all. And what I like about British homegrown cherries is they're likely to be riper because they don't have to travel so far. If you're picking abroad and you're air freighting or you put them on a ship, you aren't going to pick them anywhere near ripe. Should we just stay here and scoff some more?
Yeah. In the spring, all over the UK, orchards like this one are blossoming. And what they're doing is attracting insect pollinators. Now, that very short flowering season is a treat for our fruit growers.
I always look forward to blossom. The trees always look at their best at this time of year.
Andy's not alone. In spring, fruit farmers all over the UK enjoy one of nature's finest shows.
It's lovely to see the seasons moving on and the growth stages.
Once we see the flower in our fruit crops, you know, at least we've got a chance of getting a good crop.
This is both exciting and a nervous time of year.
What happens now and for the next few weeks will determine what level of crop we have and ultimately what harvest.
We want to be absolutely sure the bees have done their job. We have such a short window, maybe 2 weeks, to get the trees pollinated.
If you don't get pollination, you get no fruit.
We're praying for good weather, forever looking at the weather forecast and hoping things are going to go well for us.
If we can just see the sun shining, the insects flying, and all the blossom pollinated, then great.
It's so stunning that it's really easy to get carried away with the romance of blossom. But of course, every single flower is there to perform a function. They need to be pollinated by insects if there is going to be any fruit crop at all. But what exactly is pollination?
Stefan Gates has been exploring this fascinating example of cooperation in nature.
The key to a plant's success is sex.
And that's where pollen comes in. Each microscopic grain carries the male reproductive cells of a plant. For a plant to reproduce, its pollen must reach the female parts of another plant.
The trouble is, plants can't really travel, so finding a suitable mate can be pretty tricky.
And that's why lots of plants rely on animals to act as go-betweens.
To attract animal pollinators, plants entice them with dazzling displays of flowers rich with nectar and scent.
Insects, and in other countries, birds and even mammals, feed on the nectar, and in return, they provide an invaluable service.
Flowers contain both male and female parts. If you look at this beautiful lily, you'll see that up here, these yellowy-brown things, these are called the anthers, and they're utterly drenched in pollen.
The anthers are the male part of the flower, and their prominent position is no coincidence. They stick out so that any visiting creatures are sure to get a thorough coating of pollen, pollen that they'll then carry to the next plant.
Hopefully, it will drop some of that pollen onto this part here, the stigma, which is the female part. And when the pollen drops there, it travels down all the way down to the bottom to the ovaries.
Once it reaches an ovary, the pollen fertilizes an egg. The flower can now develop seeds, and in some plants, the tasty fruit around them. And with that, the plant has successfully reproduced.
Back at the farm, Andy's team of workers are still busy picking his bumper crop of cherries. They're three quarters of the way through the harvest now. But these cherries are only here because of a very different workforce. Commercial fruit farmers, like Andy, rely on an army of insects they buy in to pollinate their crops. Back in spring, I went to help Andy on one of the most important days of his year. Bee Day. It's the 29th of April at Lower Hope, and the blossom is due to emerge any day. Andy's got millions of bees, of several different species, all being delivered to the farm, ready for the massive pollination task. First, the honeybees. For centuries, we've relied on them to pollinate our fruit crops, and they're still vital today. But with advances in fruit production, they're no longer enough. Andy's got such a high density of trees, and the commercial value of his harvest is so great that he needs literally millions of bees. He can't only rely on the honeybees and the local wild bees, he actually has to import more from abroad, like these bumblebees.
So why can't you just rely on the wild bees?
Well, there just aren't enough of them. The wild bees live all over. Who's to say they're not going to be in the hedgerow or down the road somewhere on somebody else's crop? Basically, it requires millions of bees, quite literally, to pollinate this farm. And it's just vital they're actually here and not elsewhere.
Andy buys his bumblebees from a factory in Slovakia that breeds them specifically to pollinate fruit crops on farms right across Europe. Here, the queen bees are selected, mated, and then they lay their eggs. When the colony is big enough, the bumblebees are boxed up and shipped to farms like Lower Hope. This practice is fully licensed by Natural England, but still has its critics.
So do you have any conservation worries about importing bees from abroad?
No, no. They are actually a British subspecies anyway.
Right.
So they're native to this country.
So they're not going to battle with our own species?
Not at all. On top.
What about disease?
Well, again, the environment they're produced in is very sterile, so I've personally got no concerns about pest or disease. We need these bees to have a successful harvest, and without these guys, we'd have no cherries.
With the stakes so high, this year Andy's also trialling a third species of bee. He hopes it could have a significant impact on his cherry harvest and help boost our native bee population too.
These are mason bees, so called because they build walls of mud in their nest, like a stonemason does. Now, these are actually quite solitary bees, but although you don't see them in big numbers, Andy has a suspicion that they might be extremely efficient pollinators.
Mason bee expert Chris Whittles is releasing thousands of these native bees into the orchard today. When it comes to pollination, he believes the mason bee rules.
But let's have a look at them before they go in. So here's a pot of mason bees. Why are they better?
They've got a very short life cycle once they emerge, only perhaps 6 weeks. And in that time, they've got to collect all the pollen to put into their nest tubes to reproduce themselves ready for next year.
It's the mason bee's natural life cycle that makes them so ideal. As soon as these bees hatch, they mate. Then the males die and the females go on an intense food-gathering mission, visiting lots of flowers in a very short space of time. They have to collect enough pollen and nectar to feed their developing young before they die themselves. That's why Chris thinks they're the most effective pollinators.
But what will be the proof? How will we know?
Well, we'll see a lot more cherries, much better quality,
yeah.
And they will taste beautiful.
Just 2 days after we put the bees out, the orchard came alive. Andy's bees were hard at work pollinating the blossom that would eventually turn into cherries.
Well, what's particularly lovely for me is seeing the difference between just blossom on trees to all these festoons of fruit and leaves. It looks so, so different.
Yeah, yeah, it does, and it's a fantastic crop, as you can see. An enormous crop of cherries.
So the bees all obviously did their job, but we were particularly interested in the mason bee. How did they perform?
They've done a fantastic job. We're certainly going to extend the trial.
Right. So next year, the mason bees continue their work.
Oh, very much so. Yeah, we will be putting a lot more bees in and over a wider area.
Yeah, yeah, OK. Well, it's all very well having this bumper crop, but then you do need an army of people to harvest them, don't you? And handily, Gregg, even as we speak, is learning how to do that with Bev.
All these little bits at the top, this is all next year's fruit. So literally, if somebody goes like that and rips that off, that's next year's crop gone.
So how do we, forgive me, pull without pulling the...
Well, you get the cherry, you hold it by the stalk, and then you just pluck them off like that. You must never touch the fruit, because the fruit will bruise with your fingers.
Listen, I'm going to eat a few of these as I go round.
No, you're not going to eat them.
What do you mean?
You're not allowed to eat while you're picking. If you're seen eating on the field, you will be sent off the field and you won't pick again.
I'm a thirsty man in a brewery here. All right, rules are rules. Do you want to come out? I'll get in.
Make sure that you place them into your pennet, don't drop them. Don't pick the ones off the floor, because that's dirty now. I think you're getting up to speed, so I think we need to put you in a team now.
Righto.
I tell you what, this is a hive of activity. Sorry, fellas. Hi.
Hi.
George?
Nice to meet you.
I am your new star picker.
Okay, hope.
Where do I start?
This is your first tree, this is your second tree. Just please, can you stop your trolley here?
I'll tell you what, my trolley is going to be going up and down here so fast.
No, you don't need to move your trolley. You just stop where is your trees and that's it.
Right, okay. So this is my tree?
Yeah, this
All
is
right.
your first.
So, I've, oh.
Yeah, please, you need to start from the top of the branch.
Yes, of course, I knew that. Can I just ask you, what do you do when the cherries are leaning over the other side?
You can just jump from the other side. It will be easier for you to come here and from here to pick the, you see, just like that, just right. like that.
These seem a lot harder than where I was before.
What about this one, then?
That's good.
No, it's not. Just have a look on the side. You see? It's a small mark, so it should be on the... No.
George, I'm nowhere near as fast as your guys. And it seems that everybody really has their part in a team. In your experience, what makes a very good team?
The guys need to be motivated to earn money, and with helping each other, you know, it's... we're finishing the tunnel as fast as we can. After the pickers, there should not be any fruit on the tree.
I tell you what, though, it's hard work, and there is no way that you can do this by machine. Philippa, who's always looking for the easy way out, she's found a fruit that you can pick with a machine. Trust her.
Rob Saunders is the man in charge of buying 90% of the UK's blackcurrants. He's the chief taster for Ribena. Only when Rob's happy the currants are ripe can the machines roll into action on farmer Anthony Snell's field.
So what's the verdict?
They're black. There's the right balance of sweetness and acidity. They're ready.
The race is on for grower Anthony Snell and his team to harvest these blackcurrants and get them to the press within 24 hours. Otherwise, they start to ferment.
Vibrating fingers at the front of the machine shake the blackcurrants off without damaging the bushes. The fruit is caught by a conveyor that takes it to the back of the harvester, where it's sorted, ready to be pressed into juice.
How can you harvest fruit with a machine? Because ordinarily, it's so delicate that you need pickers.
It's a much more robust berry than strawberries or raspberries. And of course, it's all going for juice. So it's absolutely ideal to be mechanically harvested.
So how much does a machine like this cost?
It's an expensive machine. It's about £100,000, but it's replacing 100 people.
British growers produce around 12,000 tonnes of blackcurrants every year. They might have got the harvesting sussed, but growing them in our unpredictable climate isn't always easy.
Something isn't quite right in the world of blackcurrants.
At the pressing plant, Harvest 2013 is more frantic than ever. What normally takes 6 weeks is being compressed into just 5 weeks. The big freeze last winter meant the blackcurrants ripened all at the same time, just like Andy's cherries. Now the juice pressers are having to work overtime. But long term, the business faces a more serious problem. Not boom, but bust. 2013 has bucked the trend for warmer winters. In previous mild winters, bushes didn't get the chill hours needed to make enough fruit, so recent harvests were poor. Ribena have been working with fruit scientist Dr. Rex Brennan, who might just have bred the answer on a nearby trial plot. A new variety with a snappy name.
OK, this is 95212.
Ah, 95212. Yeah. Looks like every other blackcurrant bush that I've seen today, but I'm sure for you it's not.
Absolutely not. It is a variety that we'll hope will be released commercially, and one of the attributes it has is that it needs significantly less winter chilling than some of the previous varieties.
Now, the big thing, of course, is the taste of it. Mm-hmm.
That consistency is really important to us because people recognise the flavour of the drink and it can't change over time.
For 95212 to become part of Ribena's future harvest, it has to make it through an expert taste panel. So, I've helped Rob harvest a sample ready for testing by the professionals. Time to see if it makes the grade.
Try not to snort it. Really, the cranberry notes are very pronounced.
It's almost a very slight hint of boiled sweets on it.
We're looking for that leafy, almost catty...
catty?
It's called a ribes.
When have you tasted a cat? The thing is, no-one's actually mentioned blackcurrants. I don't know what to make of that.
Each criterion is marked from 1 to 5 and averaged into a single score.
OK, that's a magnificent 4.4 final
good,
result.
Is it?
That's fantastic.
Yeah? So what does this mean for the future of 95212, then? That's the big question.
95212 has held up really well. We know that it's well-adapted to warm winters, and it tastes great. I think we're very likely to release it as a variety.
So does that mean growers like Anthony will be growing it commercially in the future?
This will be part of the future of blackcurrants in the UK.
Well, I'll drink to that. Cheers.
Mm, best of health.
Yes. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. It's actually really nice and quiet and peaceful, just the rustle of leaves as people are...
Everybody's busy.
Which is a minor miracle, because I've never known it be quiet with Gregg around. How are you doing?
I'm concentrating.
Not very well. Those guys have picked way more than you have.
I've just emptied two trays.
Concentrating, that's the key to keeping him quiet. I'll remember that. So, Andy, what's the most difficult part of this whole process for you? Because obviously you're not doing the picking, are you?
No, just deciding when they're ripe.
Deciding when... Well, how do you know? Who decides?
Every variety has its ideal colour. This variety, Sweetheart, is best when it's this sort of colour, like a dark red. Like that.
Look at that.
You see? Got a lovely, even, dark red.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah. Would you like to try one?
You know the answer to that, yeah. It's lovely being able to eat the fruit here, down here. Well, that tastes beautiful to me.
Yeah.
That's exactly how it should be.
That's right, that's perfect.
But do you get the supermarkets coming in and wanting to test them before you pick, or...?
We do get them visiting, but we tell them when they're ready at the end of the day. There's only a couple of people on the farm that can make that decision, because it's a vital decision.
So, presumably, if you got that wrong and a whole row of cherries was picked before it was ripe, it would be a bit of a disaster.
Yes. You see, there's a variation in colour within this tree, mm-hmm. and it's always like that. But this fruit, a little bit red, if you'd like to try that, mm-hmm. you'll notice the difference.
So, just had a ripe one, so... Did you... No flavour?
No. Nowhere near.
That's fascinating. The difference is really, really clear.
Yes. So, the art is to decide when the overall tree is fit to pick, because you're always going to get a few trays like this. There's a picking window of maybe 3-4 days.
OK. So what's going on? What is ripening? And why is it so important to fruit?
Plants create fruits for one very simple reason: to spread their seed as far and wide as possible. The tasty fruit tempts animals to eat it.
The seeds inside the fruit pass through the animal's gut and are deposited far away from the parent plant. But creating that fruit requires a huge investment of energy for a plant.
That apple contained over a tablespoon of sugar, which the plant had to painstakingly create using photosynthesis.
So plants won't give up their fruits until the seeds inside them are ready. And that's why unripe fruit is so unappealing.
These unripe apples are dry and sour. They are packed with carbohydrates, but they haven't yet been broken down into the sweet sugars that we can taste.
Until they ripen, most fruits are green so that they're well camouflaged within the plant. Once the seeds are mature, the plant produces a syrupy-smelling gas called ethylene. This causes the fruit to become sweeter, darker, and much more appetizing.
For the plant, this is the potential for a future generation. But for us, it's a food packed full of flavor and essential vitamins.
All right, boys, keep picking, okay? Quick, 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 more cherries! I tell you what, these guys work fast. As soon as I've filled up these trays, they are loaded up and they're off for processing. Now, I've been working fruit and veg for over 20 years, and I'm telling you, what they're doing is picking these ripe and trying to get them to the supermarkets within 2 days. That is very impressive. Fruit of this quality in that quantity, that is great.
Once the fruit leaves the orchards, it comes here, to the pack house. Every day, the team pack 25,000 punnets. The cherries are chilled to slow the aging process and reduce the risk of decay. Then machines wash and grade the cherries, sorting them into their different sizes before they're put into punnets. But every punnet must weigh the same.
The accuracy is really quite impressive. Yes. Green light, go ahead.
Now I've got to turn all the cherries face down so the heat-sealed lids don't get punctured by the stalks.
It's like tucking them up in bed. See, when I buy these, I don't even think about the person who's lovingly packed them.
Once they're chilled and packed, the cherries have a shelf life of about 5 days.
So here they are. Clearly the best ones were mine. Ready to go to the supermarket for us to buy them.
Every fruit-laden truck leaving the farm advances Andy's dream to help revive UK cherry growing. But how was this year for him? The weather was kind through the winter until it went on so long it felt like spring would never come. But Andy got the polytunnels up in time to protect his army of pollinating bees, and they certainly did their job. July's heat wave could have threatened the harvest, but by venting his tunnels, Andy was able to make the most of the sun and use it to ripen his bumper crop of deliciously sweet cherries. Now harvest 2013 is coming to an end. Andy and his team have picked 300 tons of cherries, and there are only a few small pockets of the orchard left to harvest.
It's really hard work in the pack house. And actually quite cold as well.
But it's very important that we keep the fruit as cold as possible to extend its life.
Right, OK. And how about the picker here? Was he...
He wasn't bad. You'll get there slowly.
I tell you what, you are tough.
I know,
you
I'm tough.
You know the toughest thing is not being allowed to eat them as you're picking. That is like torture, because this is serious quality fruit. What sort of harvest have you had?
It's been a good harvest this year, sort of, as opposed to last year with all the rain. We had much better weather all through the season this season, so we had good yield, good quality, and we've actually managed to make a bit of profit. What we need the money for, really, is to reinvest. We like to sort of keep looking forward, looking for better techniques, better varieties, and more cherries.
I think that's lovely, that actually what you want to be is the best you can possibly be.
Yeah, that's a philosophy of the guys that work here, myself and all the other guys. We try to do the best job we can and be the best out there.
The sun's going down now, end of the day, end of the growing year for you.
It is.
You feel satisfied?
Satisfied, definitely. It's always a little bit sad, really, to finish the season. But to be honest, the years go round, don't they, rather rapidly as we get older, and we'll be starting to work towards next season.
Well, I'll tell you what, well done, because I'll quite happily sit here and gorge myself senseless on this stuff. I really will.
You're very welcome to, mate.
But, of course, it's not just the local crop that we're interested in. It's the national fruit crop as well. So how did that do?
From early reports, we can make some predictions. Let's start with our cherries. Like Andy, most cherry farmers are happy. The total British cherry crop is 3 times bigger than 2012. Around 3,500 tonnes. But our cherries are still dwarfed by Britain's ever-expanding strawberry crop. In harvest 2013, we grew 20 times more strawberries than cherries. Those berries were bigger than usual and sweeter too. And blackcurrants? After a couple of lean years, good winter chill, plenty of sunshine and perfectly timed rainfall means our blackcurrant farmers are smiling, up 25% on 2012. It's still early days for the apple harvest, but the picture looks rosy compared to 2012, when terrible weather slashed our crop by a third. Harvest 2013 is almost back to normal, thanks to the sunny summer. The apples may be a little smaller than usual, but they're likely to be sweeter. And our grape farmers are likely to celebrate. In 2012, they struggled to make about 1 million bottles of wine. This year, we estimate grapes are up and up and up. There's likely to be 3.5 million bottles of British wine if the good weather holds. Cheers!
Well, overall then, the fruit harvest nationally has been quite good, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been a very good harvest. I gather that the grapes exceptionally well. Apparently it's going to be a vintage year.
Hey!
Also our friends that are just down the road tell us.
So can
yeah,
we have a...
talking of grapes.
Can we have a small celebration then?
Be great.
I think it's lovely. Worth it. And particularly because apples did so badly last year as well and the year before, so it's really nice to finally have a good apple harvest.
Yes, yes.
And it must be nice for you guys to get to the end of a day. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, of course, although we're back at it again tomorrow.
Are you, Bev? Is that the case? Is it you get to the end of the harvest and actually the work doesn't really stop?
You get to the end, they all go home and we start cleaning ready for next year.
Do you pull together or are you pushing them along?
A bit of both.
says Gregg with a taste of experience. Well, what a year it's been. Better harvest than last year on the whole, I think. But then, of course, we've only touched on just a few crops, really. And if you want to find out more, of course, you can. And you can get hold of this harvest leaflet. Just go on to our website, bbc.co.uk/harvest. It's got some more information, but also some rather lovely Gregg recipes in it.
Yeah, there are some really nice recipes in it. And it will also give you details of free harvest events near you. Get involved, it's part of your heritage, and it's fantastic food.
It's been a really good harvest, hasn't
it? It's been brilliant. It's been absolutely brilliant.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Cheers.
Anytime.
Cheers.
Not going anywhere, are you?
No.
We've got this. You all right?